الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم ما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته everyone. I'm really really excited to help you get to know and myself all over again get to know Surah Yūsuf, one of the most profound, beautiful and unique surahs in the Quran where an entire narrative is dedicated to one story. Quran usually has multiple stories in one surah or snippets of a story, but this time it's a dedicated discourse beginning to end in chronological order for one individual, and that's Yusuf alayhi salam along with his brothers. This is a surah where you could literally spend years taking up a passage and deciphering how many, you know, bits of wisdom, drops, you know, gems of wisdom are embedded literally ayah by ayah, phrase by phrase. It's an absolutely overwhelming and profound study that has incredible amounts of insight. The first thing I'd like to say from a contemporary point of view about this surah is that this is a surah in which especially students of psychology should, those of you that are interested in psychology and sociology, you should pay close attention to this surah. There's actually a really famous narration about this surah that I want to share with you, which is not commonly appreciated. It's actually a man coming to the Prophet ﷺ and saying, "Aqri'ni, tell me what to read. Just tell me something to read." You know, and the Prophet ﷺ told him to read, you know, the surahs that have alif, lam, ra in them. And why did he tell him that? And he actually mentions in this story that he has a problem. The man has a problem. "I've become old in age, you know, kaburat sinni and ghaluza lisani. You know, ishtadda qalbi wa ghaluza lisani." He says, "I've become old aged and my tongue has become tough. I'm really mean when I talk. And, you know, my heart has become hard. I'm not sensitive anymore." And he recommended surahs with alif, lam, ra. And this is important because now we're learning that this surah has a profound impact on one's, you know, it makes you more sensitive. It softens you up, you know. And so that's one of the benefits of this remarkable surah. What I want to share with you about this surah are a few things. That I'm just absolutely fascinated by it. And I can't get enough of this surah. Every time I dig into it, I find more things that I just never even thought of. And really, all of them are almost a book by themselves, a study by themselves. But I want to start with some basic themes. I won't absolutely get to cover all of them, but some of the unique themes about Allah and how we think about Allah himself that come out of this surah. And then I'll tell you some things about the story. I think all of you might be familiar overall with the story of a young boy whose dad loved him very much and whose brothers were very jealous of the relationship that dad had with him. And as a result, they kidnap him, they make this entire plan. They were almost ready to kill him, but they kidnap him, they put him away in a well, and he's taken from there and by some caravan who illegally sells him off as a child slave and as a servant. So he's now a butler in some castle in Egypt, and he lives his life as a servant. And so this is a pretty disturbing story about a child being kidnapped and then turned into a child slave. Like, if you watch that in the news nowadays, you'd be disturbed, you'd change the channel. Like, as a parent, it's hard to watch that. But now we're listening to this and reciting this profound story. This is very, very real. The suffering of a child away from his loving dad. And the suffering of the father not knowing what happened to his kid. These are indescribable kinds of pain. But then Allah's names in this surah, really fascinating. Allah says, for example, "Wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi." This is the only time in the Quran Allah uses this name for himself. "Wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi." And Allah is dominant overshadowing all of his affairs. Ala amrihi. Whatever happens to Yusuf, Allah is dominant over it. Like, Allah is keeping a profound eye on it. And he's in complete control over it. And this name of Allah, ghalib, ghalaba, to dominate, to overcome, to overpower, is used. But then you're like, where's God when a kid got kidnapped? Where is he when he's being thrown in a well? Where is he when he's being sold off? Where is he when he's falsely accused? And even after his innocence is proven, he's still thrown in jail. You know, where is he when he asked for some people for help to be released from prison and they forgot about it? Where is God in all of this? And yet Allah says he's ghalib. But then he balances that with another one of his most profound, subtle names, very rarely used in the Quran, in this surah, "Inna Rabbi latifun lima yasha." My master is subtle for whatever he does, with whatever he deals with. He's subtle. He's extremely powerful and dominant, but the way he deals with things and the way he dominates situations and controls situations is almost invisible. It's subtle. Latif and lutf in Arabic is not just niceness. It's actually subtlety, where you don't notice something. That's why in Surah Al-Kahf, when the young men were supposed to kind of sneak, young men were supposed to sneak into town and nobody should notice him, وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ. He should be extremely subtle, not to grab any attention. Meaning the way Allah does things doesn't get your attention. He doesn't do things after announcing them to you. His plan is always at work in the background and you don't even realize. لَطِيفٌ لِمَا يَشَاء. So His dominance is now coupled with His secrecy. How secretly He does His plans. Now, if you take those two themes, then you realize, well, somebody could be subtle and we don't know and they're dominant, but then how are we supposed to understand their plan? There are two other names of Allah that occur in this surah, beautifully strategically situated. And these names of Allah come all over the Quran, but the way they're used in this surah is absolutely mind-blowing. And those names are Alimun Hakim, the one who knows and the one who has wisdom. The one who knows and the one who has wisdom. Look, even if you're powerful, doesn't mean you act with wisdom. Even if you're subtle, doesn't mean you have all the information before you acted. But these two names balance those two other names. Allah's dominance and Allah's subtlety is coupled all the time, is always ever present with Allah's knowledge of all things and Allah's wisdom. Allah knew how the reunion was going to happen in the end. Allah knew all of these were important phases for Him to go through. Allah knew that this is going to be profound inspiration for the final messenger of Allah one day, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who himself is going to be exiled by his brothers, because that's when this surah was revealed, when the Prophet himself was exiled by his own people. He found hope in this surah. This was revealed in the year of sadness. And it's interesting that the word Yusuf, even though it's not an Arabic name, is closely related to the Arabic word Asaf, which means sadness. And the surah has moments, profound moments of sadness as you travel. Now check this out. In the beginning of the surah, he tells his dad a dream, and the dad is full of hope. And he mentions that Allah will fulfill His favor. يَجْتَبِيكَ رَبُّكَ وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَدِيثِ وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ. Oh my goodness, Allah has chosen you and He's going to fulfill His favor upon you. And He's going to fulfill the favor upon the family of Yaqub. He talks about Himself, just like He did to your ancestors, Ibrahim and Ishaq. You know, your master is Hakim, Alim Hakim. Your إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Your master is knowledgeable, meaning Allah is knowledgeable, and Allah has all the wisdom, meaning, wow, Allah is going to grant this kid knowledge. He's going to give him wisdom. Those two names are being used to describe this optimism for what is in the future of this child. So remember, Alimun Hakim first occur in the context of optimism. The second time, قَالَ بَلْ سَوَّلَتْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسُكُمْ أَمْرًا فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ عَسَى اللَّهُ أَنْ يَأْتِيَنِي بِهِمْ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Second time, so many bad things have already happened. He's been kidnapped. He's gone for years. You know, there's a drought. They don't have any food. The sons go off to Egypt to find food. They don't even know the minister they're talking to is actually their own brother. He plots to actually have one of them, Binyamin, the youngest one, arrested and withheld for other reasons. Now they come back. The brothers come back to their dad a second time, empty-handed, without a son. You know, first they took Yusuf, now they took Binyamin, and now they come back empty-handed. So this father has received bad news after bad news. Remember, the first time he used Alimun Hakim, he was optimistic about a good future. But now so many bad things have happened. And on top of all of that sadness, another son is gone. And he says, whatever you thought easy for yourselves to do, you did. Allah is the only one whose help can be sought. Allah knows everything. He's all wise. In other words, he trusts Allah in the worst of situations. Allah has wisdom in how He does things. I don't see how He does things. I don't understand His plan, but He does have a plan because He's wise. And I know what I know, but there's a lot I don't know and only Allah knows. So I'm just going to be quiet and trust Allah. The second time Alimun Hakim comes, it teaches us trust in bad times. The first time it taught us optimism. We should be optimistic about our future. When things happen that are beyond our control, we should actually rely on Allah's knowledge and His wisdom. And finally, amazingly enough, the reunion happens. Everybody's together. Yusuf alayhi salam puts his parents on the throne. There's a massive celebration. And what does Yusuf alayhi salam say? Inna Rabbi latifun lima yasha, innahu wal alimul hakim. The third time the names occur. My master is so subtle in how he does things. He's looking back now. You know, hindsight is 20/20. How subtle and how invisible Allah's plan was all along. And how amazingly, by the way, if Yusuf was not in prison. Think about this. If Yusuf was not in prison, And he did not meet those two prisoners, then a drought would have happened, regardless. But there would never have been someone to give the suggestion that Yusuf gave. Hundreds, if not hundreds of thousands of people would have starved to death if Yusuf didn't go through what he went through. And it included the survival of his own family too. His own brothers and their families and his father and his mother, they would have starved to death if this didn't happen. That's just one of the things that was going on in the background. There was a greater good that needed to be accomplished. And by the way, as a result, he's able to sponsor all of his family to Egypt, and they settle in Egypt, which means the children of Israel now live in Egypt, and the saga of the Egyptians and the Israelites begins, which is when what will eventually lead to the coming of Musa alayhi salam. All of this begins with what the trials of Yusuf alayhi salam. If that didn't happen, none of this would have happened. Allah knows. But Yusuf looks back at his life and says, Allah knew all along. Allah had wisdom all along. Now I see it. In other words, the third time you use Al-Alim Al-Hakim, as you look back in your life and you appreciate the wisdom that at the time you couldn't have appreciated. This happens in you and your life and mine all the time. There are bad things we go through. We're like, why is this happening? And at the time we just trust Allah and say, Allah is wise, there's a plan. Years later, you look back and say, man, that if that bad thing didn't happen, if I didn't lose my job over there, I would have never gotten this new job. I would have never moved here. I would have never made these friends. I would have never, this, all the good that happened in my life was a result of one bad experience that Allah put me through. And that can happen. It's happened to me. You know, and this is the idea of Alim Hakim being a sentiment of gratitude. Now, quickly, I want to share with you, this might be a little bit overwhelming. So I make dua that, first of all, I'm clear in being able to tell you this. It's really cool how the story plays out. I want to walk you through it. I've put letters next to it just for organization purposes. The first part A is Yusuf alayhi salam sees a dream. He tells it to his dad. The second part is that his brothers make a scheme against him. The third part is, and this is, you know, the scheme, and it plays out, they put him in the well and all of that. The third major part of the story is when the minister's wife tries to seduce him. And the fourth major part after that, D, is when a similar attempt is made by the women of Egypt, the elite aristocratic women that were called to a party, and they all tried to seduce Yusuf. And then Yusuf is imprisoned. Thereafter, the king sees a dream. Now, what happens in the prison, that's all part of that scene where he's imprisoned. And then the king sees a dream, and he sees a weird dream that he tells his people. Then one of the servants sees that, you know, actually I know someone who can interpret the dream. So they call Yusuf. So the king's dream is the first to be, it gets interpreted. Then Yusuf is released from prison as a result, because he says, I can interpret it, but I'm not coming out until, you know, I'm not coming out until my innocence is proven. But he is officially released, even though he's volunteering to stay inside. Then the Egyptian ladies confess to what they had done long ago with him, because they had schemed against him. This is followed by the minister's wife. She herself admits what she had done. And then eventually the brothers of Yusuf come back and the whole scheme is made and they confess to their mistakes. And finally, Yusuf's dream that started was fulfilled, which is, you know, he saw a dream that 11 stars, the sun and the moon are prostrating because of him. Now, these are just the scene by scene depiction of the surah. What's remarkable is that it's a complete symmetry. In other words, the first piece that I mentioned was Yusuf's dream. And the last piece I told you was Yusuf's dream is interpreted. It's fulfilled because he, you know, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars are right before him, humbled right before him. And that's the last part. If you notice the second part of the story, it was when they plot, his brothers plot against him. And the second last part of the story is when they learn their lesson. The third part of the story is the minister's wife attempts to seduce him. The third last part of the story is the minister's wife admits that she was wrong. The fourth part is women tried to seduce him. The fourth last part is the women admitted that they had tried to do such a thing. The fifth part is Yusuf gets imprisoned. The fifth last part is he's released from prison. And right in the middle, the king sees a dream and Yusuf interprets the dream, which tells you that Yusuf interpreting the dream was one of the most important things that had to happen. Why? Because lives were at stake as a result, right? So it's actually a story that merges together right into the center, and the center is actually giving you what the profound larger good was in all of the suffering that went on in one household, and how many people were saved, how much more suffering was saved as a result, and Allah even saw them through by the end, and everybody benefited by the end, subhanAllah. It's a complete literary symmetry for an oral tradition, for a recited tradition to be this profoundly organized is just absolutely mind-boggling. How does Allah do that, subhanahu wa ta'ala? So here's the last part about Yusuf. So this is incredible organization, but one thing I didn't tell you is that this surah begins with not the story. You know, Alif Lam Ra Tilka Ayatul Kitab al-Mubin. You know, نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين. The Prophet is being addressed in the beginning of the surah. We're giving you the most profound of stories you had no idea about. That's what the Prophet's being told. The last passage of this surah is also an address directly to the Prophet ﷺ, in which the Prophet is told, look, there are some people, no matter how you try, وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ, they're not going to become believers. You know, no matter how much you try. Don't worry, don't try to impress them. There are some people who are just a lost cause. And there are, you know, and you're not asking them for any compensation. مَا تَسْأَلُهُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ. All you have to do is أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ. Just keep calling to Allah with eyes open. You know why Allah said that to the Prophet ﷺ? Because things were becoming so impossible. He's calling his brethren. His brethren are the Quraysh. He's calling them to Islam. They're just not listening. They're not listening. They're not listening. They're so hopeless. And he's actually recalling that a father couldn't even convince his children to get their act together in the story of Yusuf. He couldn't even get them. But eventually they came around. And so the Prophet ﷺ is being given hope. Look, it's going to happen. Don't worry about it. And at the end, جاءهم, look at this words. ظنوا أنهم قد كذبوا جاءهم نصرنا. Prophets came before and they were convinced that they've been called a liar. They've been denied. Then our help came. So Allah mentions by the end of the surah, the prophets were themselves convinced nobody's going to believe in them anymore. And then our aid came. You know what's amazing? When did the aid come to the Prophet ﷺ? The aid came to the Prophet ﷺ, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. When you see people entering into the religion in multitudes, hordes, at the conquest of Mecca, which is going to happen years later. This is a Madani, it's a Makki surah. That's years later. And years later, when finally the aid of Allah came, and the Prophet ﷺ is dominant over his brethren, and they're embarrassed for what they did to him, just like Yusuf's brethren were embarrassed for what they did to him. What does the Prophet say to the gathering of the idol worshippers, his own brethren in Mecca? He says, I will say to you today what your brother Yusuf said to his brethren. What my brother Yusuf said to his brethren. لَا تَثْرِيبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْيَوْمِ. He borrowed the words from Surah Yusuf. No harm shall fall upon you today. Just like in this surah, the Prophet was commanded or told, given hope, you know, aid is coming. When aid came, he remembered this surah. And he said, I'm going to say no harm shall fall upon you today. Reconciliation between me and my brethren. SubhanAllah. May Allah Azza wa Jal help us appreciate the profound beauty and the endless beauty of Surah Yusuf. JazakumAllahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.